här var några av de mest kända scenerna i Francis Ford Coppolas filmer. Coppola, han är en central gestalt i modern film, inte bara amerikansk film. Han är väldig, inte bara till yttre formatet. Han har dominerat amerikansk filmliv väldigt länge. Han har varit producent, regissör, författare, inspiratör. Han är en fantast och en fantasifull människa. Man märker väldigt mycket att han har ett italienskt påbrå. Det finns ofta något operamässigt i de här filmerna. Han tar stora risker. Han är en fantast, lite grann som Orson Welles, som framförallt är livrädd för att vara medelmåttig, för att göra det förutsägbara, det som är lätt att göra. Med de här riskerna följer också att han har misslyckats många gånger, att han har gjort ekonomiska, ibland också konstnärliga fiaskon. Han har fått betala för allt det här. Flera gånger har Coppola fått gå i konkurs och lämna allt han äger och har. Den nya filmen av Coppola heter Tucker, en man och hans dröm. Och det är en slags självporträtt. För det handlar om en annan amerikansk fantast och drömmare och idealist, fast i en annan industri.
Chances are you've never heard of Preston Thomas Tucker. Dreamer, inventor, visionary. A man ahead of his time. Pretty, isn't it? Mr. Tucker's car has everything. Pop-out safety windows, rear motor. Oh, but I'm getting ahead of my story. The first time he ever saw an automobile, he was just a young boy. In his excitement, he found himself with the wheels of that automobile passing over his feet. But the muddy road was soft. He wasn't hurt. And that was the first view of the machine that was to mold his thoughts and actions for most of the years of his life. Determined to learn how cars were made, he went to Detroit, where he met Vera Fuqua, who worked for the telephone company. They were married and, wasting no time, began a family. But he never lost sight of his dream, which was to design and manufacture the finest automobile ever made. He spent every minute he could at the Indianapolis Speedway and teamed up with automotive legend Harry Miller, one of the greatest designers of racing cars who ever lived.
Coppola och Vittorio Storaro, den italienske fotografen, har gjort många filmer tillsammans. Nu gör de alltså Tucker i en övergiven bilfabrik. Tuckers bil, den byggdes i bara 50 exemplar innan tillverkningen blev stoppad av korrumperade ämbetsmän och den amerikanska bilindustrin som kraftigt ogillade uppstickaren Tucker. När man ser de här bilderna där Coppola gör sin film om den våghalsige, uppkäftiga entreprenörens öde och drömmar, så leds tankarna till ett gammalt Coppola-citat som låter så här. En filmregissör är som en man som springer framför tåget. Han måste springa hela tiden, lika fort. Försaktar han av eller snubblar, ja då blir han överkörd. Men Coppola reser sig gång på gång. Och nu gör han alltså Tucker med hjälp av gamle vännen George Lucas som producerat filmen. Tell me, how did you, in the first place, how did you get the idea to make a film about Tucker?
Well, I'm a child of the post-war generation. I was born in 1939, so when I was six or so, we saw the end of the war. And right after the war, there were many products that were coming out. We all thought we were now going to be part of a wonderful new future world. And my father, being that he lived in... we lived near New York and would come from New York City, was interested in this type of new inventions, new products, and so we had television in 1946, and we had a tape recorder, and one day he brought home a picture of the Tucker automobile and said, well, this is going to be the new cars, and we kids thought, oh, this looks like a rocket ship, you know, we were very excited, and one day he took us to see the car, and we ordered a car, and he invested in the company. And then, of course, years and years went by. There was never this car. And we asked him what had happened. He said, well, the car was too good. And we didn't understand that. Or how can the fact that something be good mean that it will never happen? And I think it was that thought that was so... really, I didn't understand it. And later, in when I was older, and I tried to learn more what had happened, and I realized that... there was maybe a story there about inventions and about America that might be interesting. And so over the years, I wanted to make it as a play. When I was 17, 18, and I was learning about theater, and then later I wanted to make it as a musical, and finally, years later, I got the opportunity. I think I made it like a musical, like a play, like a, you know, like all of my younger ideas, I was able to combine all of them.
The dreams can come true, ladies and gentlemen. Don't let a Tucker pass you by.
Filmen om Tucker, den har inslaget av musikal, liksom nästan alla filmer om Coppola. Det här draget, det finns redan i hans första riktiga film, Big Boy. Här blandas underground, psykedelisk pop och naiv optimism i sann och äkta 60-talsanda.
Come on and dance with me, Bernard.
När Coppola gjorde Big Boy, då var han 27 år, men då var han redan en veteran i filmindustrin. För han hade gripits av filmen mycket tidigt. Han var teaterintresserad som pojke, men han gjorde sin första film redan när han var 9 år och då på 16 mm. Sen när det blev dags att studera universitet så åkte han till UCLA i Kalifornien, ganska nära Hollywood alltså. Men sitt verkliga universitet, det fick han hos Roger Corman. Och i Cormans studio, där träffade Coppola de unga talangerna i amerikansk film. Det var George Lucas, Jack Nicholson och många andra. Och de fick lära sig yrket genom att regissera, skriva, klippa, spela i utomordentligt dåliga filmer. B-filmer som var laddade av skräck, monster och sex. Och Coppolas egen första film hör väl hemma i skräckfilmsgenren, för den heter Dementia 13. Redan från början var Coppola en intensiv motståndare till Hollywood-systemet.
Well, I think producer is probably the most confused that term, as I use producer, which is not filmmaker producer, but producer, promoter for producer, agent producer. We got all kinds of producers, swimmer producer, tennis player producer. That kind of man is probably, by nature of the fact that he is terribly overpaid, the most frightened man in the world. So he cannot venture a film on something that's merely an idea. It has to be a book. It has to have had some approval from someone. Now, as this kind of man becomes less powerful in the motion picture industry, and as men who are interested in film and as filmmakers come into power, then I believe that it will be dominated solely by original work for film.
Men Coppolas stora genombrottsfilm Gudfadern byggde på en roman av Mario Puzo. Coppola, som är släkt med en maffiafamilj, har en naturlig känsla för italienskt familjeliv. Det kan man se i den här scenen där gudfadern själv, Don Corleone, spelat av Marlon Brando, gifter bort sin dotter.
Carlo, we're gonna take the picture.
Wait a minute.
No, Michael, not me.
Okay, just a little pause. Okay, that's it. Just like that now. Hold it.
both your parents were Italian-born, or Italian?
No, they were born in America, but all of my grandparents were born in Italy.
What has this heritage meant for you as a filmmaker, as an artist? Maybe?
Well, I think that in the home we had certain advantages from in that I did receive a very typical American upbringing, but in addition we had wine at the table. We had pizza when no one knew what pizza was. We had Verdi and Puccini, and we had the stories of artistic tradition that had been in Italy and which is still so powerful in Italy and which is today the source of Italy's economic revival, that those people brought from Italy to America. And when we were made to feel like immigrants and a little bit shunned in those days, that he said, well, you know, he says, Italy had Michelangelo, and Italy had the Renaissance, and Italy had Rome, that we were given some sense of to identify with those ultimately Western European traditions.
Well, obviously, your heritage helped you as a filmmaker, at least two of your films, The Godfather 1 and Godfather 2. Was it that reason why you were given it, that you were
heading down? I think so. I think they were looking. Godfather was a very inexpensive film when it was made, and I think they're always looking for a cheap young director, and if he's Italian, maybe that would be good. And I think with The Godfather, it was good to have someone of Italian, because very often Italians were portrayed in movies in a very stereotyped way, and it was interesting to see in a story about gangsters real Italian family life, you know, where the spaghetti on the table really was spaghetti. It wasn't some kind of phony prop, you know.
Det finns ofta ett drag av melodramatisk italiensk opera i Coppolas filmer, som här i Gudfadern 2. Vi ser den unge Vito Corleone begå sitt första mord, och samtidigt pågår en religiös procession. Filmen om Gudfadern blev väldiga ekonomiska framgångar. Och nu hälsades Coppola som Hollywoods nya kejsare. Han som skulle förnya den lite trötta amerikanska filmen tillsammans med några andra regissörer och producenter, framförallt då kamraten George Lucas. Emellertid så var Coppola och är en ganska besvärlig kejsare, nyckfull och mycket dyr, mycket anspråksfull. Redan när man gjorde Gudfadern så blev det väldigt dyrt. Men det var ingenting mot vad som skulle ske när man gjorde Apocalypse Now några år senare. För den filmen drevs hela tiden under konkurshot och hot om kommande katastrofer. Det här är en film som skildrar Vietnamkriget, eller utspelar sig i Vietnamkriget, fast den egentligen bygger på en roman utav Joseph Conrad. Emellertid så är det här en film som helt försakar den konventionella krigsfilmsrealismen för att istället växa ut till en slags Wagner-opera.
wasn't interested in taking a realistic action war adventure, which is what I had to do in order to make a film that would make money, and do a kind of Guns of Navarone set in Vietnam. Rather, I wanted to explore the, if I may, horror, or the battle of good and evil that is in all of us, inside of us, and put that outside in terms of a stylized Vietnam War.
Horror. Horror has a face. And you must make a friend of horror. Horror and moral terror are your friends. If they are not, then they are enemies to be feared. They are truly enemies.
Överste Kurtz lever i en dystert, ruvande filosofisk drömvärld, och den entusiastiska bilfabrikanten Tucker, han har sina ljusa, optimistiska drömmar. Ibland kan man få för sig att drömmarna är viktigare än verkligheten för Coppola, både i filmerna och i hans liv.
Well, I think one answer might be that I was a person who had a very strong childhood, my father being a musician. My mother was quite a childlike woman, very beautiful woman, who always, like many, maybe perhaps Italian women, kept the quality of magic going. I always sort of believed in magic in a way, because of her and of I think superstitions and, but in a nice way, and also because our family moved. From place to place, very often those feelings were, I think, really retained in me, so that I do approach, even as a mature person, man, I do approach things very much from those original feelings that I had when I was young. I never forgot them, and very often when I am in trouble, or I want to understand better things, or what life is, or what being alive really means, I tend to try to go back to what I first thought when I was very, very young. And I think that gives, that's partly a source of my strength, is my ability to retain a child's point of view. But that is very often a point of view of more of intuition and magic than it is of cold reality. It's why I like theater more so than naturalism.
I filmen Älskling, jag hatar dig så går Coppola längre i teatermässighet och abstraktion än någonsin tidigare. Här har han faktiskt byggt upp hela Las Vegas i sin studio Zoetrope. Allt är plast och neon, datagrafik och elektronik. Den här filmen, den blev ett dyrt, glittrande, vackert fiasko.
This hair? Look, I don't know. It wasn't my idea. I didn't know. You know, the guy said this is what they wear nowadays. It's very in.
Little boy blue, come blow your horn. The dish run away with a spoon. Home again, it's Saturday morn. And never gets up before noon. She used to render you legal and tender. When you used to send her your promises, boy. A diller, a duller, unbutton your collar and come out and holler out all of your noise. Little boy blue, come blow your top. Cut her right down to the quick. Don't sit home and cry on the 4th of July around your hit in the bricks. Abracadabra, no, she's disappeared. Everything's Canada dry. So wash your behavior and rattle your cage with a bottle of bourbon goodbye. Little boy blue lost little Bo Peep. She fell through a hole in the nest. Now ain't it peculiar that she's finally cooled your big wheels like all the rest? Whenever it rains, the umbrellas complain. They always get played for a chunk. So mock it and strike it, she's history now. And you're hanging out at the pump.
You talk about Kurosawa, Fellini, Bergman, Eisenstein, Pabst. I mean, their movies are totally different one from the other. Whereas today, you talk about movies, and in the words of Godard, if you cut the title sequence off the films would be identical. The way they're shot, the way they're acted, the way the style is done is all the same. So I do feel that I disagree with American point of view that movies have to be all the same. And I do feel that the reason we have that point of view there really is more economic, that the critics, the distributors, the theater owners, the studios, all are part of a very successful economic system that works a certain way, and they make McDonald's hamburgers. And so if you make a hamburger, the critic will say, well, no, it's not the right size bun, it's not the right type of tomato on it, because it has to be a McDonald's. And my attitude is that I was trained not only by American studio system, which did used to have variety, but I was trained also from a European tradition, which in which variety was a plus.
You feel isolated in the American cinema in this respect?
To be honest, I don't really much even feel a part of it anymore. I feel I've kind of gone my own way now. I'm older. I'm no longer so interested in the things I was when I was younger in terms of the kinds of success and the prizes that are held out to be the prizes. And I'm much more anxious now to become, if I could, more in the tradition of even older literary traditions. I mean, what would have happened had the cinema been given to Goethe or to Ibsen or to Joyce or to Shakespeare, and what would they have made films? They wouldn't have made Rambo. They wouldn't have made what everyone acknowledges is what we have to do. So, I mean, I'm talking about real giants, of course, but they seem to be these giants over all of our history, and yet today we don't seem to have that type of work done anymore. And so without being as Joyce did to Ibsen, where he wrote him a letter and said, well, I am the new Ibsen, still I would like to follow them in some way.
Men det har blivit mer underhållning än Ibsen för Coppola under 80-talet. Han har mest regisserat andras filmer, men då och då så glimtar det till av formvilja och inspiration. Today, you're blowing me no good, no. What are your relations to the American film industry like, to what is usually called Hollywood?
Well, I think I have a very different relationship to Hollywood than Tucker had to Detroit. For one thing, Hollywood created me, whereas Tucker was an outside of the outsider. He was trying to get in. I was in trying to get out. As a result, I think Hollywood has always been my strongest supporter. I mean, in Tucker's case, the money he lost was the money of stock of investors and dealers, and so in some ways he did them a disservice by letting his charm and enthusiasm, in my case, of course, the money I lost was my own money, so maybe it's not quite as questionable. But I, you know, have always, you know, being a kid who liked movies, I always liked the hero. I always liked Robin Hood. And I would always follow a Robin Hood, and I would like to be Robin Hood if I could be.
Be seated. As the jury reached the verdict,
We have, Your Honor.
Will the defendant please rise?
We, the jurors, find the defendant, Preston Tucker, not guilty.